future might just like look over.
Yeah.
That's like what's that, you know,
so maybe like that, which I totally get, and I was a little confused. Yeah. I mean, that was what I was saying, right?
Oh, yeah.
Points of fine division. The input, the center of the world, and or world, because if the world's too big, it's trivial. I mean, I have one world right where it's some data I get
basically. You're the pro.
Yeah. And what they get is the sum of the research which means they don't know really, you may bypass it because you're off, right? They're off my mind. But you should be able to, as it's getting closer, you should be able to correct it, you know, to get it in the sum.
And that's what we're doing.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Maybe. It really did.
So,
definitely more than you do.
Yeah, I would love to see some more.
I think I'm biased.
My director's like, oh, really?
I only had one result in my life. And most people I talk to don't actually understand why. This is awesome. Or you're going to be like, I don't know.
I have to guess, I would say 3 to 5 minutes. It's restarting right now. This is one of the few devices that hasn't updated with the new. Yeah, so I get to stick that in. It's okay. That's why I tried it a little earlier. Yeah. We should be able to do it because we're split screen.
Sure?
I'm pretty sure.
Okay.
I might step in.
Well, it's time to start anyway.
Getting close. I gotta get this guy started.
This is super weird.
Come on.
Put it to the
When you're done with that, I'm going to need you to set up the screen sharing because I can't get it to work right now.
Okay. Starting. Failed unauthorized. That's what I got last time. Let me see.
We're just taking an extra minute to set up the application that will send us all to YouTube.
XJ.
In real time?
Yeah, XJ.
Do Facebook Live?
Yeah, that's basically what we're going to do.
Hi, everybody. We're going to get started in just a second. We're setting up the recording. Can you hear me?
They just went away. They weren't before.
Okay. Screen sharing's not working for me.
I will be back in just a second.
Next Wednesday, right? And right on that screen there, you'll get to see some lovely scuba diving movies of me diving through caverns in Mexico and over coral reefs and all of these things. So come on in, just for fun. Beacon budget request process. If you've been keeping track, this is actually our eighth iteration. And the budget request process has gone from something that was done pretty much manually with a few Excel spreadsheets to something that happens now almost by magic through the wonders of Tim's code. There are not going to be a lot of changes from last year, but we'll go over things, talk about any questions that you have. So as I go along, if you have specific questions, please do let me know. So, as you all know, Beacon is an NSF Science and Technology Center. We have funding for a 10-year period, but we are entering the period in which that funding begins to taper. Now, after the 10 years are over, then the funding will taper yet some more. It will not go away. We're not closing Beacon. We will be working in a period where each year there will be a little bit less to pass out than in the year before. So I apologize for that in advance. That's just the way NSF works with science and technology centers. We have some wonderful news, as you probably saw a month or two ago, about ultimate sustainability of Beacon with $10.7 million in bequests and another $2 million in gifts from Dr. John Arcosa, who is helping to assure the sustainability of Beacon and evolution in action in the long term. And of course, his gift is responsible for the hiring of the first John Arcosa Endowed Chair in Genetic Programming, Professor Wolfgang Bonshoff, who is with us now. Don't expect Beacon to go away, but there will certainly be inevitable changes when we go a few years down the line. For this next year, there'll be a little bit of change in amount of money that's available, but other than that, there won't be any significant changes in the process. So what's that going to look like? Well, each year, the partner universities historically have received $500,000. This year, they'll get slightly less than that, and there will also be slightly less available at MSU for us to allocate. So whereas in the past, we've maybe allocated 40-some projects at a level averaging somewhere between 80 and 100-some thousand, we may be allocating a few less than that this year. We will be allocating fewer than that or at smaller dollar amounts in the coming year. So that's something for you to keep in mind if you're trying to decide whether you wanted to hire 7 graduate assistants or 8. Go for 7. But as usual, the executive committee is going to go through and prioritize all these projects, and the projects that get funded are those that are prioritized most highly by the executive committee. And we'll go through the remainder of the process here as we go along. But in shorthand, we can say that first of all, the thrust group leaders, and we have 2 of those in each of the 4 thrust groups, and you're probably familiar with those, they will each appoint reviewers, and those reviewers are internal to Beacon, and all Beacon members who submit budget requests are automatically eligible to be asked to review things. Other Beaconites may well be asked to review things, whether they submit budget requests or not, but certainly you put yourself in the pool by submitting a budget request. After the reviewers have had a chance to read the budget requests and make their comments and ratings, then the thrust group leaders synthesize those, write summary comments, rank the ones within their thrust group, and then they go to the executive committee, which then has time to look through the budget requests, look at the ratings by the reviewers, the rankings by the thrust group leaders, and then integrate those rankings across all the thrust groups. That's where that process happens. And the executive committee contains not only the PIs on Beacon, but also all of the partner leads in Beacon, and it includes the chairs of the diversity and education steering committee, our industrial manager, Dr. Chen, and so it's a widely representative group, and that's their job is to integrate all this input and come up with a ranking. Then at the end of the process, Danielle and I sit down and look at some things. The committee makes recommendations that, well, if you could fund this one, if you could chop off this or have this shared with that, or maybe these two could, you know, a few things like that. Then we may do a little bit of negotiation, but within about 3 days of the executive committee meeting having been held, we will be making the actual announcements of the awards. And we don't deviate from what the executive committee recommends. That's been our process for all the previous 7 years, and we don't expect to change it now. So, I see. This was when I could have pointed out all these lovely parts of our organizational chart and didn't. If you want to look at Beacon's organizational chart, it's on the website, folks. Look under people. Okay, now the idea of the project is that we are providing seed funding to try and put together new collaborations. That's the primary emphasis. NSF, when they come to review Beacon every year, the site visitors are told to find out from us what is it that can happen at Beacon that wouldn't happen if we weren't a center, if we weren't a science and technology center. And the answer to that is supposed to be multidisciplinarity and multi-institutionality that bring people together who wouldn't otherwise work with each other. Now, Beacon has lots of multi-institutionality at this point, so it's certainly not a requirement of the Beacon project that people come from multiple institutions. It doesn't hurt if people come from multiple institutions, but the rankings are not a point system. It isn't that every project that's going to get funded is going to be the ones that had multiple institutions. Now, multidisciplinarity is much more important and valuable at this point in our process. We are still looking for new seed research that will put people together who would otherwise not necessarily work together from different disciplines, particularly if some of them are from the biological side and some of them are from the engineering or computer science kind of areas. One of the reasons for this is that when those folks then take the seed projects and submit them to other agencies for follow-on funding, they have a much better chance of being funded if they're multidisciplinary. Okay, this is what a center can do that otherwise is difficult for people to do. So we are, in our evaluation system, as you will see, following very much along with the guidelines that NSF asks its reviewers to use. All right, so the rules that we have, the criteria that we have are very much like those used in general at NSF. Proposals typically are submitted for 1 year, and we will be, of course, increasingly as our STC funding draws to a close, this is probably the last year at which we'll even accept two-year proposals, okay? But one-year proposals are favored. That is, you've got to make a much stronger case to get a two-year proposal funded than a one-year request. Now, the process, though, if you get a two-year request, you get 1 year's funding, and at the end of the year, there's simply a check-off to see, have you been doing what you said you were going to do, and are the preliminary results as expected, and then you get your second year's funding. You don't have to enter competitively into the process for the second year. It's just a check-off. Okay, so it's nice to get a two-year project. Historically, we haven't had many two-year projects, not many at all. So people are, I would encourage you to think strongly about submitting one-year budget requests. Budget requests can be renewed. That is, if you have a current project and if it's going well, the things that we will be looking for in a request for a second year of funding would be, have you already started generating proposals to NSF to get funding from somewhere else, for example? Have publications been forthcoming? Are students in place and working and so forth? So the normal kind of things that you would expect So we don't want to be putting all of our funding into continuation proposals, but at the same time, we don't want to be chopping things off if they're going well and look very promising and have been going through the steps to try to capitalize on the work that's been done already. Okay, just statistically speaking, the proposals or the budget requests that we've had in the past year, the mean was 89,000 was last year's mean request. The range went from 26 up to 143. So if you're thinking of asking for something that costs more than that, think again, I would say. We've got less money to allocate. This is going to be a big number, okay? For education and diversity proposals, we have fewer of those. They're also typically smaller. The mean was 46,000, and the range went all the way from small things of 6,000 down to 99,000. So, again, one of the categories that we ask the reviewers to comment on, and the thrust group leaders, is appropriateness of the budget. If it looks like you're doing something that's a monster in terms of the research that you're doing, and you're leveraging this with three other grants that you have that are paying part of the salaries of a postdoc and a technician, and you can do the whole thing for $45,000, wow! You know, then people are going to say, this is a marvelous budget, and that helps. If, on the other hand, you say, well, we've got to recruit three postdocs, well, you see the other end, right? It just is not as good. So, how does Beacon funding get used in the budget request process? Well, up on the top you see the research projects, on the bottom you see the EHRD projects. You'll see that the biggest piece is graduate student support and research projects. That's a somewhat smaller piece here because we've also got a lot of undergraduate support in our education projects, many of which are summer things that involve students, REUs, high school students, other people than just graduate students doing research. And there's also a big difference in terms of the staff time and so forth associated with the EHRD project. But you can see that the research projects are basically almost half graduate student support, then a fair amount of postdoc support, and the other categories. The things that you don't put in, for those of you who are newbies, okay, the things that you don't put in your Beacon budget request are, for example, faculty summer salaries. We made a decision early on that that was not how we were going to spend our seed grant dollars. We'll spend it on postdocs, on graduate students, on tech support, on supplies, on materials, on travel, on publication costs. Oh yeah, and that's about it. Okay, so we're not paying faculty summer salaries. There are some exceptions to that at some of our partner institutions where people otherwise are teaching full-time in the summer and they need to buy out from something. That's very much an exception rule. If it applies to you, you will know that. Okay, so that's the situation. Any questions about that? About items that are appropriate? Okay. So who can apply? Basically, the people who can generate budget requests are grads, pardon, are faculty and postdocs, and they can be lead PIs on budget requests. Graduate students can be named in budget requests under the graduate student support category. They can't be the PI, but they can be named personnel. And of course, if you already know someone who this is going to support and can name that person, that can be an advantage to your project, right? I mean, then people don't say, well, will they be able to find such a grad student or postdoc or whatever? No, yeah, they don't have to look, they've already got one, okay? And if that person turns out to be someone who adds to Beacon's diversity, oh, that's a good thing as well, right? So if you can name people in your submission, that's a good thing. Now, in the early years of Beacon, we had a lot of people who used the rainfall approach you know, well, if I submit 12 budget requests, then at least two of them should get funded, right? Well, we stopped that by limiting any one person from being a PI or a lead on more than four projects and being a participant in any more than six requests. Now, nobody gets four projects funded or six requests funded on which they're involved at all. But nonetheless, we don't want to break the review process by having so many budget requests generated just with the idea that maybe one of them will get rated highly. So that's not the idea. In one of your projects, if you already have some kind of collaboration going with someone else at another institution that is not a Beacon institution, you can name that person and talk about that collaboration in your budget request, but you cannot put any expenses for that person in your Beacon budget request. The Beacon spends its money only at MSU and the four partner institutions and the institutions of the faculty affiliates, of which we've had three, okay, who are involved as Beacon members. Those are the places where we can send money. Nobody else gets money. Okay? You can collaborate with others, absolutely. Does that strengthen your proposal? Certainly it does. If you can say, they've got money to do this, and we are coordinating with them, and we're going to do this, and we pass this back and forth, and their students will visit us, and our students will visit them. Yes, could you put in some travel money to let their students visit us? Oh yeah. Us is going to pay for that travel. That's fine. Okay? Those are the things you can do. Otherwise, no. You can't send money to the other institution. Okay?
I think this is where I take over.
Yes. Now I'll turn things over to Danielle and let her walk you through the nuts and bolts of the process, how you can break the Beacon budget request.
All right, so I'm going to talk about the actual forms on the internet, a lot of common mistakes. I am the person who looks at every single one submitted and finds what you did wrong, and I contact you and I tell you to fix it, and I get really tired of doing the same mistakes over and over again, so hopefully today you'll learn what some common mistakes are and you will avoid them yourselves. Okay, so on the front page of the intranet, we've already posted the announcements. I also sent out the PDFs to everybody via email, but if you can't find it in your email, just log on to the intranet. It's right there. In addition to the budget request guidelines document that shows you, that goes over all of the stuff that Eric just talked about, I also made a screenshot step-by-step document, which is the second one there, and we'll go through that. Also, slides for today are already posted there as well, and we'll have a link to the video from today, too. Okay. So I just want to talk about some important fields. There are some things you'll need to upload. So your project narrative is two pages, limited to two pages. It does not include references. It has to be uploaded as a PDF. You have to conform to pretty standard font limitations. We're actually a little more generous than NSF is. We let you use 3/4 inch margins, 10-point font. The system gets a little confusing sometimes because it doesn't necessarily respond the way you think it's going to. When you upload, you're not going to get like a pop-up that says, congratulations, it uploaded. There's this little green link that shows here. It's a little subtle. So if you don't know if it's uploaded, if you see this, great. There's a narrative there. You click on it, it will show you the PDF that you uploaded. If you want to replace it, just upload another file. It will overwrite. Okay, that's pretty straightforward. Please make sure your name and titles are at the top of your narrative. We didn't specify this before, and it led to problems because the reviewers like to print out all the PDFs instead of reading them on the screen, and then they lose track of what's what. So make things easy for your reviewers. Put your title and your PIs on the top of the page. Okay, the next fields are where you get to suggest reviewers and keywords. This is really important for making sure that your proposal gets reviewed by people who know what you're talking about. And you will help out the first group leaders by suggesting people within Beacon who are appropriate to review this, and by giving them keywords for what's your project about, right? So there's a whole bunch of keywords here that you can put in, and then we use that to search the member database. Also, by the way, while you're in there uploading all this stuff, make sure you update your own profile on the intranet and update what keywords are associated with your name so you can be found to review things. And don't think that by not putting keywords, you won't get out of it. A lot of people know who you are.
Loophole number one.
It doesn't work.
It's more of how accurate do you want the matching to be? So do you want to review things you actually understand or random things?
Yes.
So how do you do with new keywords? Can you add keywords?
You should be able to. If you do run into any problems, please email me, Ed or Tim. Tim's the only person who can actually fix anything. I'll just forward it to him. But yes, if there's a keyword that you need and it's not showing up here, there's an add button. You should be able to add it. If not, we'll get it in there. What's that?
No
reviewers. No, the reviewers list the entire member database. So. Okay. Here's another key part. We have 8 review criteria, and I'll go over those next. And in that form is a place for you to address every single one of these criteria and say how you meet them. So there are text boxes that you can expand, but you only get 250 characters to say, you know, why you meet this criterion or that criterion. It's a good place to really sum up, you know, be explicit, you know, help your reviewers out. Say, no, I'm contributing to diversity because I'm supporting a black graduate student, and we want to know that. I'm contributing to multidisciplinarity because I'm collaborating with computer scientists. Be explicit. That helps a lot because sometimes people have to review a lot of these. Okay, what are these review criteria? There are 9 of them. The first 4 fall into what NSF calls intellectual merit. The first is scientific strength, so it's your basic kind of intellectual merit criterion. The second is centrality to Beacon's mission. How much are you addressing our central mission of studying evolution in action? The third is the quality of plan for obtaining external funding. Do you have ideas about where you're going to submit for external funding? Are you already planning on which panel you want to submit to NSF? Or do you have another funding agency you're interested in? That's really all you need to say, something like that. Like, I'm going to use this to collect preliminary data for a proposal to NSF, something like that. Just so we know that you're thinking about it. And then the fourth is multidisciplinarity, which we've already talked about a bit. The next 4 fall under broader impacts. So the 5th criterion is impact on education and human resource development. Are you training grad students? Do you have a primarily education-focused project, et cetera? 6 is knowledge transfer to industry. Does your project have potential to transfer into industrial application? This is another thing that Beacon does. Obviously, not all projects are going to do this. But if yours is going to, great, say so. 7, impact on achieving diversity goals. Are you helping to broaden participation in STEM? It's a very important goal of Beacon. And 8 is multi-institutionality. Are you collaborating with someone at a different institution? And then, of course, Eric already talked about budget appropriateness being the 9th criterion. And I want to reiterate here, we do not expect any project to be able to meet all 9 of these, right? What we're looking at is trying to create a whole portfolio that meets all of these. So if you've got a primarily research-oriented project and you've got, you know, maybe it's a biology project and you have no prospects for knowledge transfer in industry and you're not working with someone at a different institution, but you meet some of these other things, great, that's fine. Don't try to make stuff up to try to fill all of these. We don't expect you to. We want you to emphasize what things you are doing that are great. All right, funding rates. We do better than NSF here, yay. these are numbers from every year so far. The dark blue are funded projects, and the light blue part of the bars are projects that were not funded, that were unsuccessful. We have been having about a 35 to 40% success rate in the last couple of years. It was a little higher before, but it's gotten more competitive as people have submitted more. Funding rates tend to be a little bit better for, these are education and diversity focused projects. There tend to be fewer of those to compete with. And of course, that is a very important part of our mission as well, so we do like to make sure that we have those kinds of projects.
And they're cheaper.
And they're cheaper in the year's portfolio. So again, we're trying to achieve all of our goals through a range of projects. And so as you can see, we typically fund 35 plus 14 is 49, so in the range of 45 to 50 projects total a year.
And fewer this year?
It will be fewer this year, unless everybody's budgets are smaller.
Yeah.
It's possible. online. Okay, the budget. This is where we run into problems because this is internal and you don't have to go through CGA or your local grants office. That makes it challenging because we don't all know all of the things about how much is our fringe benefits for my grad student. You're not going to necessarily know that. I strongly recommend that you get help on this, if you are, especially if you're hiring personnel. Get someone in your department, whoever is the person you would go to with an NSF grant, for example, to help you out with figuring out salaries and fringe and tuition and all of that if you're going to support people on your grant. Presumably you will. So
let me just caution that when you do that, go to those people and say, I am not submitting an e-transmittal. This is not going to contracts and grants. It's not going anywhere off campus. This is internal money that I'm applying for. So I need the numbers, but don't do any paperwork for me.
Yes.
Okay? Because otherwise, some people have in the past generated a lot of work for people that
yes.
is completely very confusing, actually, to the whole system.
Yes, so don't make sure that, in case everybody on the partners heard, make sure your administrator knows you don't have to go through your grants office or you will upset and confuse people. This is all just going through this website. And if you don't ask for enough money, so if you say, okay, I'm going to hire a postdoc, I'm going to pay them $40,000 a year, and then you don't put in how much you need for fringe benefits, well, you're probably not going to get awarded that, and then you're not going to be able to pay that person enough. So please don't do that, because then you'll be sad, and you'll make us sad, and we hate screwing people over, so don't put us in that position. Okay, next item, equipment. It is highly, highly unlikely that any of you are going to be requesting equipment, but it is highly likely that you're going to put something in this line, and then I'm going to call you up and say don't do that. Equipment, we are using the NSF definition of equipment. I think it's the institutional definition of equipment as well. Equipment only refers to a single piece of equipment that costs more than $5,000. We usually don't buy any equipment. A computer is not equipment, right? Anything like that, anything that you might consider equipment, your field equipment, computing equipment, that's not actually equipment in this definition. That's supplies. So put it under supplies. Speaking of supplies, lots and lots of things are going to go there. The other category is not for sequencing costs or things like that. It's actually that's a leftover category. If you put something in other, I need to know what it is. And if you put sequencing costs or fees in other, I'm going to get annoyed and I'm going to change your budget and put it in supplies and put in a note in there. So anything that involves lab work or computing or field equipment, that's all going to go in supplies. So make sure that's right. Others or anything that goes in other, if you've got something really, really weird, just email me or call me. I'll help you figure out where it goes. All right. All of this will have indirect costs as part of your budget. The budget form is already preloaded with indirect rates for each of our partner institutions, and it will calculate them automatically. If you have a weird situation, maybe you're working with a different institution with a different rate, or you've got a different rate because it's an educational project, talk to me, and we'll figure out how to get it in that rate.
Where does Trevor go?
And the travel part, I didn't get to that.
Oh.
Travel I actually didn't put up there because people don't make mistakes with travel. Everybody understands that one. So there is domestic travel and foreign travel. Yes.
Can we jump back 1 second? You said yes. Education projects will have different, could have different rates?
Not here.
Okay.
But sometimes when we work with other institutions that happens. Those okay. are very special situations. So the Beacon grant itself is subject to our full indirect rate, and we can't reduce it for anybody within our 5 institutions. So, sorry to get you excited there. Yes.
And when they put in the direct costs, our system is smart enough to calculate the indirect for them, right? So they don't
yes.
have to worry about trying yes. to calculate.
Correct. You will not have to calculate your own indirect costs. The system will do it for you. We've put in the right rates for each institution.
So the funny thing you do have to put in is the information for postdocs about fringe benefits
yes.
and the information for graduate students about tuition and fringe benefits. And those are all handled differently. And we don't do those automatically because
right.
they vary from college to college within the university. They vary, so that yes, that's when we're sending you to your departmental budget person or whatever for help, right?
Yeah. Mike.
So I've gotten the message that we almost certainly don't have anything in other. Do you have any examples of something that actually qualifies in other?
Something that actually qualifies as other would include consulting fees if you're working with somebody outside of a university. What else have I put in other?
So imagine if your study area is on some farmer's land, and he's willing to let you go in and do your research if you give him a bottle of vodka. Would that go in other?
We can't use federal funds to pay for alcohol.
Good try. For presentations.
Oh, but actually, though, if you do have to pay fees to someone to use their land, for example, that might be something you put in there.
Okay.
Very strange things that don't come up for most people. Just ask them about it, and I will do it. That is my whole job for the next month. Okay. Personnel. This form can get a little unwieldy because there's a lot of different things to take into account. So at the very top of the form, which I'm not showing here, but at the very top, you will choose from the drop-down menus people who are going to be on your project. Don't forget to add yourself, and then any other people. If you've got somebody that you don't know who they're going to be yet, you're going to recruit a new grad student, for example. There are existing names in there that are like future grad students. So please don't make another one. Choose one of those. Future grad student gets paid an awful lot. But that's okay. That's not a problem. Okay, so for each person that you've added, they will appear at the bottom of the page for you to add proper information. So even if you're not giving people salary, please choose their correct role. It won't pre-populate properly. So I've got Eric Goodman up there. He's an MSU faculty member. I had to click that. I've got myself, I'm an MSU other. We've got a future postdoc at Idaho, right? So for each of these, you will need to pick from that menu the correct role for them. Even if you're not paying them salary, we want to make sure that information is in there correctly. And then depending on which role you've picked for them, it will offer you different kinds of salary options. So for faculty members, the only option would be summer salary. Again, we strongly discourage that, but if you've got a weird situation that you need that, that's where it will be. For other kinds of employees, there are different things. So for postdocs and others, so say you're hiring a lab tech, you will need to put in the annual salary, annual fringe, and then how many months you're paying them. If you don't fill in the number of months, it will say zero, and your total will be zero, and you will get $0. Don't put in, if you want to pay somebody for 3 months, don't put in the 3 month salary. Put in the 12-month salary, and then put three in the number of months. Same for postdocs. For graduate students, it is a different way to do it because we pay the stipend, the graduate student stipend, fringe benefits, and then tuition is special because we don't have to pay indirect costs on tuition, yay? So make sure you're getting that entered in separately and correctly, and that way it'll all come out right. Okay. Any questions about that? I'm always here to help run into any issues with them. Okay, almost to the end here. So education projects have a slightly different criteria. If you look at the budget request guidelines document, at the end there are some appendices, and it will talk about what's slightly different for education projects. For education projects, we encourage an evaluation component so that you can test and make sure that whatever you're doing is actually working. So if you're planning to submit an education budget request, I highly recommend contacting our education director, Louise Mead, who can help you figure out what to do about that if you're new to program evaluation. She is very experienced with these things, and she has put together some examples of different kinds of evaluations and assessments that you might want to use depending on the project. And again, she can tell you much more about this than I can. I highly recommend getting in touch with her if that is appropriate for your project. As Eric mentioned, we do allow two-year project proposals. You may submit that. Again, it will be subject to more scrutiny than a one-year. And if you are funded in that second year, so if you received a two-year project last year, you'll be getting an email from me soon telling you what to do next. Because at that 1 year, to make sure you get your second year funding,
We just want to report back to the executive committee that you've been making progress on this. So you'll submit a very short progress report. The progress report that you submit in September is usually too soon after you got the money to tell us anything useful. So we ask for something at this stage so we can see how you're doing and, you know, make sure it's okay to give you more money. Okay. And reviews again. Any person in Beacon may be expected or may end up being asked to review budget requests. If you submit a budget request, you will be expected to review some, up to five. For each one of your own budget requests, you're expected to review up to five. You probably won't get 20 if you submit four, but you might. And again, Thrust Group leaders will assign appropriate reviewers based on those keywords in your intranet profile. Please keep those up to date. Those reviews are submitted on the intranet itself. The submitters will be able to see those reviews once the decisions are announced. So you can log in, you can see what scores you got on each of those criteria, you can see comments, and we really encourage all reviewers to please be as constructive as possible when submitting their comments, because this is feedback for all of us. We're a community here. We learn from each other, we get advice from each other, and this is useful when applying for other funding as well. So this is a great opportunity for us to give useful feedback to each other. The reviewers are anonymous. And that's all I have to say about that. All right, here's our timeline for this year. The intranet submissions opened on Monday, so you can go in right now and start filling out a form. The deadline is February 15th. It will be that evening, midnight, Pacific time, since we do have partners in the Pacific time zone. Then the Thrust Group leaders have a week to assign reviewers. Those reviews are due March 13th, so you've got a few weeks to do your reviews. And then the Thrust Group leaders take back those reviews, read through them. They also review everything themselves, and they do a ranking of everything in their Thrust Group. And they submit those rankings to the executive committee. And the executive committee will be meeting on March 28th, actually. And we will be notified of the funding decision by March 31st. Okay. Your project was funded. Yeah, congratulations. What do you do now? Okay, so the funding will be available starting in the summer. If you need it earlier, talk to us. But typically it goes from the summer to the next summer, or it can start in the fall and go from fall to the next fall. The account itself will be managed through your home institution. If you're collaborating with somebody at a different institution, that money will be broken up based on how you put it in the budget. So say you ask for $12,000 for you here at MSU and $15,000 for your collaborator at Idaho. That $15,000 will be sent to Idaho in our sub-award that I issue a new one each year. If you are here at MSU, you will receive a sub-account number from Connie, and you can contact her when you need to spend money out of that, when you need to find out how much money's still in it. It's all managed in your own separate little sub-account. You are probably aware there are reporting requirements associated with this. I have to submit an annual report to NSF and what we've been doing with all the pretty money they give us, and so I need to know from you what you've done with our money. And so I ask that you submit a progress report in September. Ask is a kind word. I nag that you to submit a report. And we also need to know any other kind of outputs from this project. And not just, you know, what you did this year, but, you know, what did you do in the last, with funding you got 2 years ago that you finally published now, right? I think these things take time. Please report all of those things in our intranet so that we can tell NSF who we did. Isn't it great that you're giving us money for science? You want to keep doing that? And then as a Beacon member, and particularly as a Beacon member receiving funding, we want our members to be contributing back to our community and participating in seminars, at Beacon Congress, writing blog posts. We want to share all of our research and activities with each other. So that's an expectation. And if you receive funding and you haven't, for example, written a blog post, Travis might be hunting you down saying, hey, you should write about that great project we funded.
Okay, yes.
Let me just inject one thing here. When you get, when your project is selected for funding, you will get a brief award letter. And one of the things that it will say in that award letter is that you were funded for the period such and such to such and such. We expect you to spend your money during the period from such and such to such and such. However, if due to circumstances beyond your control, da-da-da-da, which sometimes happens, then we will give you a 6 months grace period beyond the period that you asked for, in which you are expected to spend that money. At some point beyond that, money that has not been spent will be reallocated for some other nice project that can spend the money. So when you're given the money, concentrate on getting it spent during the time frame that you said, and or within 6 months after that, because after that, then it's our money again, not your money, okay? So please do keep that in mind.
Okay. I think this is, yes, this is the last slide. Oh, and I just want to point out too, we want all of our Beacon members to participate in these things, even if you don't get funding. We still want to hear about your cool work, so please don't feel like you can't do this. Please don't feel like you're not a member of the community, because you are, and we value all of you. Okay.
One other thing along that line.
One more question.
Sorry. Just the following. We presented to our site visitors in December, and one of the things that we presented were all these nice bar graphs where showing you the number of proposals submitted and the number of proposals funded, and then there's a little yellow place in between where it's the proposals that are still pending. Well, what we showed them was graphed for year one, two, three, four, and like for 3 or 4 years ago, we still got a big yellow area of proposals that are pending. Okay? They're not pending. It means that you did not go back in and say this was funded or this was declined. So, you know, after 4 years, I don't think they're pending. So please do go back when you log in, go to your outputs and activities, just so you were entering something new. Any of those old items, even if they're 3, 4 years old, there's an edit button. You push the edit button and then you could say declined or funded. And then those yellow bars will go away. So we do appreciate you doing that, because what's happening is the site visitors are saying, what do you mean you don't know how many were funded or which one? That's stupid. Go find out. Well, yeah, except that I don't have any way to do that. So I depend on you to do that. So. Oh, please, please, do that. Thank you. The proceeding was a paid political announcement.
All right, questions? Yes, sir.
So Danielle, you and Eric have both suggested we not try to hit all the buttons or check all the boxes design criteria. But at least the feedback that I got and other people have gotten last year suggested that the scores were pretty much added. And so I've spoken with a number of experienced Beaconites who have advised me quite cynically, just check all the boxes and fill it up with bullshit if you have to, because, you know, if they don't believe it, they can give you zero. That's what you have anyway. If you're just, if the whole thing is a numbers game, then you just got to get the numbers. What could you comment on that, please?
Yes, I can comment on that. I will start by repeating it just in case the microphone didn't pick you up. The question was asked, I said earlier, do not try to check all of the criteria boxes because we don't expect any project to, but feedback in the past has suggested that the scores in each of those simply get added up and then you're just listed based on your total score. We strongly, strongly, strongly discourage that sort of ranking. And in fact, we advise the Thrust Group leaders not to do it that way. Some of them like to play around with math and see, okay, how does that add up if I do this? And you know, that. Some people like writing scripts for things and running data. But that is not how funding decisions are made. And that might come up in your reviews because they do have to comment on each one of those. They might say, well, you know, I gave a low score for this because it doesn't do knowledge transfer. But that is not, each of the projects, are the projects that everybody loves, right? And then everybody's like, this is great, this is top priority funding. Those get sorted to the top of the list in that executive committee meeting, and they're generally funded. Below that, every project is discussed. It's a long meeting. Don't enjoy them. But this is not simply a numbers game. When people bring that up, we respond with, that's not how we want to view these projects. This is part of a portfolio.
So, and we do, I mean, I will have a meeting again before the process takes the next step, where I'll be meeting with each thrust group leader and going through and saying, the way to do this is not to add up the scores, okay? That's not the idea. So they are all cautioned not to do that. The reviewers have no opportunity to add up the scores. I mean, that, you know, they're doing the scores. So, you know, we don't ask them for a summary or for a, I should say, a ranking of things, all right? Because any one reviewer sees too few things to be able to do a good job of doing that, right? So the thrust group leaders, however, get a chance to look at all these things. So we try to get them to look at it again from a portfolio point of view. If it's a project that does not make any sense to be suggesting knowledge transfer, then we say, you don't take off points because they didn't get knowledge, didn't do knowledge transfer. That's not appropriate for this project. On the other hand, if it's a project that is begging to do knowledge transfer and they don't talk about it, then that's a mistake. Okay, so that's the way that we work with the thrust group leaders. That's the first level at which people try and integrate. So we depend on some level of intelligence and judgment in this process. Then beyond that, again, the executive committee does this, and we talk about all these things, and believe me, we don't go through and say, you know, let's add up the rankings and see what they got. So that's just not that's not the way that it works.
Mike? Just as a data point, one of my proposals last year was for 3 months for me. So, you know, male 40s, lone scientist, one department, almost no biological relevance. But it was I'm surprised you guys funded it. But just as a data point, you know.
Well, we can reconsider that.
So I know there have been a couple issues in the past that sometimes those 250 character summaries are not as easily displayed for the reviewers as we might be hoping for. Now, there was discussion last year about making that more built into the review process. Is that
yes.
going to happen?
I sent that suggestion to Tim very recently.
Okay.
And we are going to work to try to get the form a little more reviewer friendly so that you can keep in mind what you're supposed to be reviewing as you're writing your response.
Is there a greater emphasis on working with other vegan members versus working with non-vegan institutions?
I mean, we don't discourage working with non-vegan institutions, but we do like to see collaborations growing within vegan. That being said, most of my collaborations are outside of vegan too, so it just depends on the project.
Does vegan have a position on the discussion about postdoc minimum salaries?
I'm going to let Eric answer that.
I'm sorry, discussion.
Does vegan have a position on the discussion about minimum salaries for postdocs?
Is under consideration in the legal system, and the Fair Labor Standards Act, which would have gone into effect, which would have put a minimum salary, was blocked in court, and so is not in effect. So the university stopped the process of adjusting salaries based on Fair Labor Standards legislation because it was not allowed to go into effect. So at such times as the court cases are resolved, then the institutions will make those decisions. But Beacon right now is not free to change those things independent of MSU's policy. We are governed by, you know, at MSU, we're governed by MSU policies. At Idaho, they're governed by Idaho policies. At A&T, they're, you know, but we don't have a free hand in that game.
So along the same lines, even though we can't enforce a lower-end postdoc salary, the PI still choose the salary, so we would probably encourage PIs to take, to think about that, right?
There is no...
To give fair salaries to postdocs.
Yeah, there is no restriction on what salary levels can be proposed for a postdoc. Practically speaking, there would be.
Right.
Okay. The way we've looked at it in the past, certainly our Beacon Distinguished postdocs are offered a salary which, if other postdocs were getting more than that, would make that seem pretty strange. And so that has been an upper practical limit in the past. For a long time, the governing thing was actually the NIH, which had a very low salary level for postdocs, and the rules that were in effect said that if you were appointed as a postdoc at the university, and then some grant from NIH wanted to pick you up as a postdoc, they could not. The reason being that you were already getting more than the maximum level that NSF will allow them to pay. MSU will not decrease your salary, and NIH will not increase that level. So that was a practical thing, which for depending on the departments. In the College of Engineering, it didn't have much play because we don't get much NIH support. In some of the biological departments, it has a lot more play because students, or pardon me, postdocs, might very well move from grant to grant to grant, from year to year, and then be subject to those limitations. So for some period of time, that was the level, and that is way below what the minimum FSL level, or FLS level, would be. Right now we're
that was
kind of in limbo.
The NIH has actually announced they're increasing all of the NIH.
Yes. Yeah, yeah. So that I hope that that particular problem will go away.
All right, we've just got a couple minutes left. Let me just check in, see if anybody with partners has questions. Doesn't look like it. Okay.
Traditionally, Beacon has paid for grad student postdoc travel to the Beacon Congress. If there were undergraduate students funded by Beacon working at other institutions, would they be included in that general framework, or should that type of expense be included in the budget request process?
That's usually considered on a case-by-case basis. When undergrads work on projects and they want to present at Congress, we bring them here, yes.
Okay.
Yeah, great.
Yes. I have a question about authorship criteria. So if, like, myself as a grad student, if I wanted to spearhead a Beacon project and then get assistance from another grad student, we could be listed as lead PIs, but could be listed as co-PIs.
Yes, grad students can be listed as co-PIs.
Okay. And then should we list our respective advisors? Like,
that's up to you, whoever's most appropriate. You'll need to have at least one faculty member or a postdoc as the lead PI.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, tangentially related, is there a plan for Beacon Congress to continue after the end of the initial, the 10-year funding?
There is not funding in place guaranteed by anybody to allow that to happen. Would that be something that we would want to have happen? Yes. Are there conceivable mechanisms that could support that? Yes. Do we have anything in the bag? Absolutely not. So that's a serious concern. There are a number of things like that that, you know, we can see seed funding for projects at several institutions continuing beyond the 10-year STC domain. We can see a certain amount of central staff services going on. But the cost of the Beacon Congress would eliminate the salaries available for any central staff, and then there would be nobody to put on the Congress. So no, that's not there right now. And yes, that's a concern, absolutely.
Related to that, does the COSA endowment allow continued budget requests after the end of the 10-year base funded period, or is that just for the endowed chairs?
No, it's for a variety of things. One of the things that it would provide for is graduate fellowships, okay? Mm-hmm. And so those fellowships would be allocable on some basis and could be added to the pool, just as we do today, of money that's available to allocate for projects. Again, in the case of the COSA endowment, that's money that's available here at MSU. And when the 10 years are over, MSU will not be sending money to the partner institutions, right? So that they're not eligible for that sort of fellowship aid, but MSU personnel still would be eligible for that, and that could be folded in with some other things. So yes, and there are other infrastructure related things that it will provide for some support for some central staff and to take care of things that are for the good of the field, as it were. And that can help us with our staffing demands and accounting demands and things like that. So, but that, of course, is all in the indefinite future. We have no idea when that funding will become available to Beacon. It won't be, I expect, in 2020. So.
Okay, so we're out of time. If you come up with more questions, please don't hesitate to contact me or Eric or whoever the appropriate person might be. We're here to help you for the next, get through this process and do your best science. So thank you all. This will be available online too.
We will definitely work it out.
What did I do?
There's always something that breaks. Yes, well, I mean, half the number, you know, but still, enough that you had to have a system. First year was the math.
Yep, that's fine. Yeah, I put that in my calendar. Yep. Yep.
This would be right. Fall. There's I don't think that's the same question.